Maybe we can get started. My name is Ari Tanninen, software engineer, product manager, all kinds of stuff I've done. I got stumbled on this responsibility process years ago in some agile something way back in Helsinki, I guess. And I got really interested in this stuff about 5 years ago when I had a small slight meltdown, or I guess it's called a burnout, and started reshuffling my life and values and whatnot. Brilliant, once you get the Zoom okay. Been practicing responsibility for 2.5 years in a practice group with Christopher Avery, the guy who's done it. And by the way, if you know what the responsibility process is and you know the power and control cycles, then might as well leave. This probably won't be anything new to do. So I'm curious what my audience is like. So how many of you would characterize yourself as a techie or developer of sorts? Quick raise of hands. Okay, what about business people? Business side? Okay, and management? Okay, how many of you, I mean, please raise your hand if you got really pissed off during the last week or upset about something? Okay, you're a human being. Good, congratulations. Welcome to this talk about the responsibility process. What is responsibility? How would you define it? What does it? What does the word bring into your mouth? Come again? Okay. Oh yeah, yeah. Avoid it, indeed. Any other takers? Is responsibility light or heavy? Yeah, usually heavy. Sometimes not. Anything else? Keeping promises, yes. Oh, making them. Right, exactly. Come again? Delivering promises. Oh, that's the tough part, isn't it? Okay, anything else pop to mind? Gonna be trusted. Okay, trust is there. So this is kind of heavy duty stuff. Okay, we'll dig in deeper. Keep that in mind for a second. Self-assurance, that's pretty good. Okay, I'll try to remember to get back to this. I wanted to tell you a story about my life. I live in a housing condominium. We have 12 houses, apartments. Here is one of the tenants. They're grumpy as hell. They've been living there for 35 years, and we had this discussion about underground drains that were supposed to be installed in this entire housing cooperative. Turns out they really weren't, so I just got screwed 20,000 euros when I bought the apartment there. I wasn't too happy about that, but I was willing to work on that. So we are having the first general meeting of this cooperative. Oh, in Finland, if you buy an apartment, you essentially buy company stock from a special company that owns that one building. That's called a housing cooperative. So we have a board, we have a hired CEO, who is kind of the landlord, taking care of maintenance and all money issues and so on. And these old tenants were quite displeased with how things are going now, because they wouldn't understand, what the hell is this landlord? Why is he spending our money? Why is he costing us so much money? Why isn't everything painted in tip-top shape? Why isn't everyone plucking needs? And who the hell are you young people anyways? You're supposed to be taking care of this place because we've been taking care of it for the past 30 years. Then we had this issue of drainage pipes, and this guy said that, well, it's simple. We installed them 20 years ago. Now you are young people. You just go and dig them up, and you maintain them and clean them. And I'm like, what the hell are you on? Besides, you just screwed 20,000 euros for me. How about you just go and fuck? Yeah, and it was an unpleasant conversation. Well, that evening then I realized that actually I kind of lost my calm and I didn't know the facts yet, and I was feeling a bit kind of shamed. I mean, after all, this is a housing collective, cooperative, and these kind of things happen, and I should know better. And we are having old people who used to live there and doing their way, and now we are having new people. Plus, we actually started following Finnish law, so we established a board and we established this landlord or a housing manager, which we didn't have before. So, I mean, it's kind of understandable. At that point, I realized that, shit, I'm actually in the board, I'm gonna have to deal with this old geezer. I'm really annoyed at that. And these stupid underground drains, I mean, just but I'm going to have to carry the burden and take accountability. After all, I'm in the board. And after about 3 hours of therapy, aka venting to my wife, I kind of calmed down, managed to fall asleep at some point. A couple of days later, I had an insight. I was like, heck, we just moved in here. Middle of the nature, it's really nice. We want to live here. I plan to grow kids here. What the hell is going on actually around here? And I started talking to some old people and new people, and I realized that the old tenants, they are actually deathly afraid because this is their home. They've been living there as if in their own individual houses. And now you have these new strange people telling that, in fact, it's not your house and I'm going to paint it. You know, you own stock. You don't own the walls where you live in. And they are deathly afraid. And I thought, okay, this has to change. I don't want to live here. So we started running the board a bit differently. Everything is open. We have every 2 months a discussion where everyone is, you know, free to come using lean coffee. We get all of the venting and bitching and all the angst that some of these old geezers had. At this point, I was still a bit tad angry and calling them geezers instead of my loved neighbors. And this produced results. Now we are a pretty happy housing community. Stuff is taken care of. People even don't mind that it pays money because the fear is kind of gone. What does that have to do with responsibility? Well, turns out there is this thing called the responsibility process that's in all of our heads. It's an automatic process that is triggered whenever there is an upset or a problem in your life. So whenever you get pissed off, maybe it's a small stone in your shoe, maybe someone screwed 1 million euros from you, whatever, likely the next step is to go blame someone else on this. Like me with this housing community, yeah, you old geezers, why don't you take care of the bloody drains? It's your fault. Well, the next step, if you get in these mental states, so this is a thing that happens between your ears, is that you actually go and you justify. Well, yeah, it's these housing collectives, they're always so problematic, and you know, the company culture is like it is, and that's why we have to, you know, sit in these boring meetings. The next mental state, so first you blame someone, then you blame the situation. The next mental state is shame. Like, I was ashamed that in fact I lost my cool, and I mean, I could have been more careful when we brought the apartment, and I mean, checked the actual drainage pipes, blah, 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 blah. And in shame, well, I'm at fault. So, if we manage to graduate from shame to the next mental state, by the way, can you see this red text in the back? Good. So after shame comes a place called obligation. Obligation is a place of accountability. It's the place where we have to, but we don't really want to. Like me realizing I'm in the board and holy shit, I'm going to have to deal with these geezers and I'm going to have to deal with these stupid drainage pipes and I don't want to. It's BS. I want to live happily, barbecue, spend time with my kid, not do stupid bureaucratic work like this. So now the next step after obligation is a place called responsibility. This is a place where, if you get to this mental state ever, things are kind of light. There is choice, there is freedom, you don't feel trapped anymore. And you can do some quite, I don't know, good decisions. For me, perhaps with the problem of drainage pipes, I got the responsibility after venting to my unfortunate wife and sleeping it over and realizing that, in fact, these old people don't understand what's going on and they are afraid. And that's the problem we have to solve. The alternative could be that I could have started a nice neighborhood war or actually joined the existing war as it was already happening. And then just basically bitch and have a horrible time whenever I see a neighbor. Luckily that didn't happen. Maybe I need to thank my wife for that. Oh, so one more thing in the responsibility process. Oh yeah, we usually draw a line there and talk about being above the line and below the line. Because below the line is where you don't want to be. Above the line is where you want to be. And there are a couple of tricks on getting there. None of them easy, I'm sorry to say. One more thing that's missing. Ooh, is a mental state known as denial. That's the place where, okay, problem, what problem? We don't have problems. We are a happy housing community. We are a happy company, and we are a happy agile company. No one bitches or gripes about anything. So that's denial. And there's one more place called quit. Quit is a mental state where you can end from obligation or shame once the anxiety of obligation or shame gets so bad that you can't take it. like, okay, forget this housing community, forget these trains, I'm getting myself a tub of chocolate ice cream and I'm watching Netflix for the next 3 hours. Or name your poison. And this is essentially what I'll be talking about for the next 30 more minutes. Does this ring any bells so far? Sound familiar? Okay, shit happens, we tend to blame someone else, then blame the situation, then we go to shame and obligation and it's all horribly heavy. And then maybe once in a while you make a breakthrough and you see stuff from a different perspective and then you get to responsibility. So it turns out evolution evolved us to be like this. This is automatic, it's completely human, and you can practice this. So I want to go in a little bit of the background. So this is essentially the responsibility process, it's coping stages. It's places where it's nice to have a holiday and not deal with the actual issue. And the idea, of course, is to recognize that, okay, I'm now in this mental state, I don't want to operate from this mental state, I want to get to responsibility where I get to do something less stupid than blaming my neighbor for everything, for example. The background work is done by Bill McCarley and Christopher Avery. And Christopher Avery is the guy, he's a Texan, by the way, who makes a living off this. And he just recently published a book called The Responsibility Process. And he's one of the best, most authentic people I know. So it's really good stuff. Okay, let's dig in a bit deeper. So whenever our heads go into one of these mental states, you can see it. There are some symptoms that you can recognize it, either internal or external. And then there is a subconscious diagnosis, how your brain explains to you what's going on, and then a remedy on how to make stuff better. Let me switch perspectives. First, there is a mental state known as lay blame. It's easy to recognize. The symptoms are, it's venting. Someone is bitching or venting about anything, or is blaming that. Dmitry there is such a lazy piece of or this gal isn't committing his code, or blah, 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 blah. It's quite easy to sound. Now, the diagnosis, of course, is that Dmitry or Mr. X or Mrs. X is responsible. I, of course, can't do anything, you know. His problem to fix. And of course the remedy is that the other person has to change. I can't do anything, I'm powerless. Now if we go into justify, same thing. It's venting, it's bitching, but you're bitching about the situation, not about another person. You know, that's just how things are. We have these boring meetings, but I mean, this is a publicly traded major corporation. That's just how things are. I spend half of my life in meetings and I can't help it. And of course, the situation is responsible. The company culture is just like it is. All these old geezers are just like it is. They should, you know, instead of bitching about their neighbors, pick up a hobby, go play some golf or something. And of course, the situation needs to change. I can't do anything about it. Next date is shame. It sounds like I'm so stupid. I shouldn't have lost my cool. If I were more brave, I could have told my boss that his meetings are boring, but I don't want to do it. And I'm kind of feeling guilt. And of course, the diagnosis is that it's my fault. Actually, I kind of deserve to feel bad about this. And I can't do anything. I need help. I need to grow. As if that were so easy. Does this sound familiar? Any? Okay. The next mental state is obligation. And this is my favorite. Obligation is easy to pick. In English, it sounds like we should, I must. This is a must-win battle. We must succeed with this project. We should be agile. And in here, basic symptom is minimal results. Because if you force a person to do something they don't want to do, they will just do the bare minimum and get it over with. It's like, this is shit. I don't want to have a deal with it, but I'll get it over with so I can have some peace. The really nasty thing about obligation is that you get procrastination and resentment. You have to study for a boring exam tomorrow. You don't want to start cleaning up your apartment, start doing all kinds of little things except dealing with the actual task. But the real poison here is resentment, because this can build over and over and over and over the years and just turn you into a horrible person, basically. And of course, in here, I have no choice. I'm trapped. I'm hopeless. It's all hopeless. Then there is this place called quit. Quit sounds like whatever. Yeah, I didn't want to have the promotion. Okay, so they killed Agile in this company. I didn't want it to begin with. Okay, our product line is dead. Whatever, I don't care. You kind of deny that you want it, but you still want it. And of course, the diagnosis in the head is, this sucks so much that I don't want to deal with it. I'm off to do something else. Where's the pitcher of beer? And then finally, responsibility is a bit different. You feel good. You feel ownership. Okay, this is shit. This is my shit. I bought this apartment. I choose to live here. What am I going to do with it? Okay, maybe somehow I contributed to the problem that we're having. Maybe my team isn't working as well as I expected. Well, maybe I shouldn't have hired that guy. Like, it's where you take ownership and where you own your problems and your life. Actually, the remedy for problems in responsibility, I'm going to talk a bit more about this at some point, is that you face the pain. You look at the actual situation. So like with me and my housing co-op, I didn't blow up the bomb. I went and bitched to my wife. I'm sorry, wife. But I didn't do anything stupid. Then at some point, I got some clarity, and I realized that actually these old tenants, they've never lived in a legal housing co-op. They don't know how it works, and they are afraid because someone else is messing with their home. And at that point, my angst vanished. My anger vanished. I was like, oh, I want to help them. This sucks. Horrible that you would feel that way about your home. So like, this is the moment of clarity that I got, managed to solve the situation. On a side note, this is called the responsibility process, but it's not quite that forward. This is, after all, psychology. It's not always 1, 2, 3, 4. It's kind of like this, and sometimes you can skip steps. This is for you technically oriented people there. This used to drive me nuts when I was studying this stuff, that someone calls it a process, and it's not exactly a process. Any questions, comments, by the way? Feel free to interrupt me whenever. I'm dumping quite a bit of stuff on you, and I really appreciate having an interaction. Mm. Grab the mic.
So, what is the usual time frame when you go from this denial to the responsibility?
Seconds to dozens of years. So, like, there was in the training program, someone told a story of a mom who used to cook for 14 years every day for her family because that's what a good mom is supposed to do. She can't stand cooking. Then she came to the program, realized that she's operating in obligation for 14 years, took a brave step, said that I'm not going to cook anymore, went home, declared the intentions, husband took over cooking. All the children ran and hugged her, said, Mom, thank you so much. I mean, we never liked your cooking, and you're always so angry and pissed off when you're cooking that this is the best thing that ever happened. So, in your head, you have a responsibility process per every upset. Like, every time you get a new upset or a problem, it's triggered again. And people can stay their entire lives stuck on some of these mental phases. Yeah.
Do you really need to take the responsibility for every problem or upset what you're having in your life?
No. And when you phrase it like that, that do you have to take responsibility, that's obligation talking. Yeah.
So how do we skip the sucky parts?
I'll get there shortly. But this is natural. We're built this way, so you can try to be better, but like forgive yourself, relax, it's okay. Maybe if you are some kind of holy guy or enlightened Buddha, you can operate from responsibility. Like Christopher Avery says, he's been practicing this and living off this for the past 20, 30 years, and every time he gets annoyed with some jerk in traffic, right, this gets triggered. He's just practiced it so that he can say, okay, I'm blaming, shut up, breathe, don't honk, don't flip the finger. Okay, back to responsibility. Next. Yes, and please, self-apply this only. It's really easy to see this process in other people. Don't ever, ever, ever say that, hey, you right there, you are now bitching, you are operating from blame, you shouldn't do that. Because then you go immediately into shame or obligation. That's hugely, hugely dangerous. Especially if you're a team lead, don't ever, ever push this on your teams. That's super destructive. And likewise, don't demand of this yourself. You can grow to be aware, you're a human being, you make mistakes, forgive yourself, try to learn, carry on. So actually, this is really big time about freedom. And like Christopher Avery says it, all leadership begins with self-leadership. First, you have to master yourself, your mental states, so that, for example, you aren't blaming everything against someone else all the time. So this is a, do this from compassion and kindness, if you apply it. And now we get to one more bit of that's missing from the model. Above the line in responsibility, there is something called a power cycle, and below the line, in all of these nasty mental states, there is something called the control cycle. These are like system dynamics, self-reinforcing loops that go on in your head. And control cycle works like this. First, subconsciously, you choose control. Then you get upset with something. Okay, this sucks. This is bad. This is how the hell do I get back in control? You make an evaluation. So you evaluate the situation. This is a boring meeting, I have lazy children, we aren't agile, we aren't lean, that's bad leadership, that's whatever, you evaluate. And what's going on here actually is that you're feeling anxiety and you would like to get back in control so you have less anxiety. So, evaluate the situation, next step is seek advice. Okay, how do I get back in control? What should I do in this situation? How do I raise my kids? How can we be more agile? How can we be more lean? How can I be a better lover? I mean, people seek advice. And there is plenty of advice on the planet, in our own heads. Thought leaders, agile coaches, holy books. I mean, the world is filled with advice. So then we go and get those advice. Ladies' magazines, men's magazines, 10 steps to a perfect relationship, right? The next step is compliance. So, the situation is this. Now I have advice how the situation will be better. Now I just need to follow the advice. Simple as that. Now I'm back in control. 4 steps to agility, 10 steps to better relationships. If I'm only more disciplined, then I could had. If I wouldn't explode so easily, I could have handled the next housing committee meeting better. You know, it's this kind of chit-chat that goes on. Only problem with this, though, is what happens if you miss a step in this compliance? 5 steps to better agility. Okay, we did, my team did steps, you know, 1, 2, 4, they forgot about 5. Now I'm upset. You guys, really, we need to get you back in control because you aren't disciplined. And then this revolves and feeds on itself. And this is the dynamic that actually fills the planet with bureaucracy and rules. We'll get back to that a bit later. Does this make sense? Ring any bells? Okay. And what happens is that we actually trade anxiety to freedom. So I give away a little bit of freedom, my kids' freedom, my team's freedom, my organization's freedom, so that I can have a bit less anxiety. And now, little by little, we build this kind of control prison to ourselves and to other people. And it feels heavy, like the feeling is like, oh, okay, more rules, more of this kind of stuff. But at least I'm in control, I don't have anxiety anymore. And this is slightly tragic. Well, now the other side of the coin is the power cycle. I mean, you can choose not to abuse the control cycle, but that takes training, and you can operate from power. And power cycle works like this. Okay, I'm having a problem. What the hell is going on in here? I'm missing something. Could be what I'm seeing is not the whole truth. Maybe my kids are lazy. Maybe there is something else going on. Maybe this old geezer is bitching to me about whatever because there is some stuff behind that I don't really know. What am I assuming exactly? How exactly is this supposed to work? The next step is clarity. I mean, you look around for the truth. You look like, actually, I didn't look around on what was happening in our housing site. I just had this moment of insight. I realized that, holy cow, the people are actually afraid. I mean, they are aggressive, but it's fear behind that. And that was the aha point. Then I realized that, okay, they're afraid. They don't know how this go. I can help them. I can educate them. We can run this board differently so that everything is open. Now when you have this clarity, you get trust. I can deal with this. I know what to do next. This is how it goes. And then this makes it easier next time to choose power as well. And now this positive cycle feeds on itself. Make sense? Yeah.
If you're really sure about the clarity, because if you are
Control cycle. Yeah, or then you can catch it and decide that I don't want to go where I'm just going to sit on it and look around a little bit. But this clarity really should be like an aha moment. It's like, okay, I got it. Okay, what the heck was going on in here? Like the clarity moment for this lady who decided to stop cooking probably was her entire family loving her for not cooking, and she's been afraid for 14 years that they wouldn't love her because a good mom is supposed to cook, right? You know, that's like a true insight, and it's really difficult to reverse after that. Okay, and now power feels like this. This is the moment of insight. This is when you get something and you realize that, okay, I now have the confidence to fix this. And here's the full model. How this kind of goes together. And it's online and everything, so no worries. I forgot something, but it'll come back. Oh, actually, a question is, why do we value control over power? Why is it so nice to control rather than be patient and look? Come again? True, but why is it so easy to go that route? I mean, I just evaluate, you're an asshole, the situation will be fixed and you'll be fired. Certainty, yeah. It's easier, exactly. This is easier, it's faster. You don't get good results, but it'll reduce your anxiety fast. So easier, faster, dark side of the force. On the other hand, power, that takes a lot of work and a lot of patience. No shouting at kids. First you sit down and establish the facts. Yeah.
You are vulnerable because you can fail, actually.
Oh, I never thought of that. Nice.
No, actually you are assuming risk because you will need to act and you will feel vulnerable at some point.
Exactly. And now you stretch it.
Yeah, and it's easy to choose something simpler, you know.
Exactly. Brilliant. I never thought about that. Okay. So now, how do you fix your life and how do you operate from power and not control? Here's the three keys. Number one, intention. Okay, I really wouldn't want to be operating from shame or obligation. I would much rather be operating from responsibility. Step two, awareness of my mental states. I had an asshole Audi driver at some point cut me off morning traffic one of these days. I almost gave him the finger, almost. But I realized that I'm blaming and this is actually quite stupid. I don't want to do it. So I didn't honk, I didn't give him the finger. Now I did vent to you about it, so maybe it's a small minus for me. But tomorrow maybe I'm better and won't get that agitated with the next Audi. Asshole. And now the third step, I'm not Buddha yet, is to confront myself. Usually, when you're really, really upset, there is something going on that you're missing. And that's the tough, hard work that you have to do with yourself. There are some tools for doing that. I won't be going in very deeply here. Tool number one is just journaling. Keep a journal. At the end of the day, okay, dear journal, today I got upset at an Audi driver. Fucking asshole. Luckily, I didn't honk. Yay me. Right? It's just introspection. Meditation, catch it quicker game is something quite easy. Take a postcard or any piece of paper and a pen. Then you start with blame. And then you go on for the whole day. And every time you're blaming someone or venting about a colleague or a stupid meeting or something, you make a little mark on that card, and that's one point for you. You noticed you're blaming. Now, if you notice that you are about to blame, but you manage to shut up, then you make a different mark, that's 10 points. Good for you. And then you keep this up for a week or a month. At some point, you start kind of getting 0 points when you start learning that, okay, I don't need to blame anymore. and then you go to justify, and then you go to shame, then you go to obligation. Then bit by bit, you train yourself to notice your own mental states. And then you can observe others. This is great fun. I mean, I bet money that next week you will see a lot of people operating from some stupid mental state at office or at home. It's great fun, but remember to shut up about it. And then you have practice groups. Right. That's the short, condensed version of the responsibility process and how it goes. Now the next step was looking a couple of leadership issues with this framing. Any questions or comments right now? Funny anecdotes anyone wants to share? Okay, in the back. Come again.
When can we download the material online?
It's there, actually. I gave the same talk in Agile Estonia, but I can stick this on Twitter or whatever. And you can email me. Where was I? What's the difference between accountability and responsibility? Any ideas? Brilliant, thanks. Okay. Yeah. Yeah. In Finnish, it's the same word.
Basically, all the other languages use the same word for that.
Yes. Yeah. So this is the old Rossi matrix.
Exactly.
Yes, right.
You also do need it, that's all.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. So annoying trick question. In the responsibility process, how this goes is basically responsibility is something you can accept out of your own free will. You can't demand anyone, but you can demand accountability, which may produce you then either responsibility or obligation, depending. So there is one more step I didn't explain one more bit I didn't explain about the responsibility model. Obligation and shame are green, and justify and lay blame are red. And actually, justify and lay blame are red because these are mental states that our society, I don't know how cultural this is, but at least Western society in general, it renounces blaming. I mean, kids are taught that, you know, you should take responsibility, and Gunnar, you took his candy, you know, give it back. You must be a good girl, and don't you blame that, you know, she poked you first, right? Stop avoiding responsibility, no one likes a whiner. Man up, you know, a good girl is supposed to behave. So it's this kind of dialogue that our parents and teachers start when we're very young, but then this turns into kind of a nasty narrative later on in life. Now, of course, the other side of the coin is this obligation and shame, which society likes very much. Because shame is, hey, you know, shame on you, Gunnar, you're supposed to feel bad, you know, for taking his lollipop. You should suffer, you know, now you must go apologize. Right? How can you feel so stupid? Okay, you're now project manager, you don't buy the project, but I mean, hey, you're now accountable, you take care of this. So our society tends to call obligation, accountability, and taking responsibility. And the responsibility process, and Christopher Avery want to take a kind of a clear separation between that. Does this make sense? Ring any bells? Okay, so this is like really hard work to get from this accountability obligation trap to some place where I am free, I can choose. And actually freedom is, or the promise of freedom, people who can decide for themselves without having a whole ton of baggage of psychological issues and kind of parent load in their necks. That's why I like talking about this so much. So now what actually happens is that some of this stuff is already encoded in business language. We have must win battles. Failure is not an option. We must do this strategy, you know, this project must succeed or else. Right? You hear the language? And of course, when you go into we must win this battle or else something bad happens. So this is actually all based on fear. And now what happens is that, you know, you start talking fear, people's lizard brain take over, they shut off the mammalian brain, you just lost emotional intelligence, creativity. All you have is a bunch of roomful of people who are trying to decide whether to fight or flight. And that's what makes this kind of super nasty. And of course, if we go back to the control cycle, now especially if a leader is operating from control, they are upset, they are maybe afraid, maybe they're running this must-win battle, then there is a tendency to start creating all kinds of rules and regulations to control the people and the organization, which means the leaders push control down. So they invent rules and policies for their team, organization, companies, and this is how the company rule book will keep on increasing, increasing, increasing. Then you get into this horrible anti-agile corporate, you know, cartoon-like dystopian universe. I'm not saying that you don't need rules and policies and controls, of course you do, but that this mental cycle is what tends to pile them on. I mean, it turns kind of draconian. Well, the next issue, of course, is that organizations tend to inherit the mental state that their leader operates from mostly. Like, this was wonderful in the old TV... I'm sorry I'm picking on Trump, but this was just too easy. In the old TV series, you're fired. So whatever happens in that entire TV series, someone is to blame. And someone will be fired. Like, this is so clearly in your face. Someone is accountable. Maybe they are first time ever managing this kind of project. They just cost you 200,000 euros or 200 million. They just learned a lesson. Now you fired them. How stupid is that? And of course, this was brilliant when Trump kind of backstabbed some of his generals. Of course, he's the commander-in-chief and ultimately responsible and completely renounced his responsibility. Now, I'm pretty sure that American generals are way more mature than that and they can kind of handle it, but imagine if you're working in an organization or a company where the number one rule of a leader or a vice president or the CEO is who's to blame, who will be fired. Like, this culture will fall down and people start adopting it in the organization. Does this make sense? Okay, then here's a person who is in probably operating from quit, I would think. Yeah, it's worthless, we just have to deal with this nonsense. Must be really fun being in her team, doing really great quality work for this kind of a person, right? I had a story about this, but it's in the presenter notes, so I'm going to skip it. Next one is here, we have a guy operating in obligation, showing some contempt because he was just handed that you must build this product that the business he doesn't believe in. So imagine if this guy's product owner, he's thinking management board, what the heck do they know? We're just now, here's the vision, here's the business case, I don't buy it by the way, here's the backlog, yay team, be excited, go build it. So how do you think the team is going to feel after that? Yay, wonderful to come to work every day. We're just going to build this piece of shit that we don't, right? I may or may not have been the product owner in question. But it falls down. So people inherit it. Okay. I won't bore you with that. And so here we actually come to the thing that I like to check nowadays first in organizations, is there anyone present in the room who says, I want? Sometimes an entire organization can get stuck in obligation. It's easy to hear. You have these board meetings or you have these management meetings where it's all about, well, we should do this and we should do that. Well, the best practice says that you should do blah, blah, blah. Well, Itil and Cobit say this and that and we really should. Well, our neighbors are going agile and they are digitalizing whatever the heck we should as well, or else. Right? You see the language? Instead of, hey, our competitors are doing this. Would it be cool to try? I would really like to. And this is a really horrible phenomenon because it's just a really nasty place of being. And also you can hear that people aren't talking for themselves. They are talking for this other guy. Well, marketing really should. Well, the developers really should be doing this. And I mean, this book I read online says that we should be. I don't really want to, but we kind of have to, right? It's just, and then you're bringing an agile coach or a motivational speaker or whoever the heck, and you start wondering why our people are not performing, and you get kind of this shoddy BS, and no one buys into the vision or seven step plan that's been laid out. And this is quite horrendous. Yeah, if no one wants anything, how can anyone expect stuff to happen? Everything, yeah, never mind. So in summary, actually, you can't force responsibility. You can't, because then people go into shame or obligation. If you control people quite a bit, at some point you're going to suffocate them with bureaucracy. And an organization inherits the mental state that you mostly occupy in. So how the heck do you lead? Now, the lesson from the responsibility process is, first and foremost, you lead by example. Try not to blame, try not to justify, breathe, find a colleague, do a private bitching session, try to figure out and understand the situation from a different perspective, and then operate as a leader. And this whole leadership thing really begins with leading yourself and your mental states and then where you are on the planet. I had something else, but... And now the dream actually is that if you have an organization or a team or yourself and you're operating from below the line, under compulsion, anxiety, impotence, you have no choice, you feel powerless, you feel kind of and the world is gray. The dream is, what if you would have this sunset? Freedom, ease, power, choice. I mean, stuff is easy when you choose to own it, but it's bloody difficult to choose to own it. One reason I talk about this stuff, because I'm living proof on how difficult this can be. I probably spent the first 8 years of my career somewhere in there, on the left side, being unhappy about an organization because it wouldn't be XYZ or conform to my arbitrary standards on whatever the heck. And I didn't have any clue whatsoever on what I wanted. And I was always operating from below the line, evaluating the situation, not seeing that it's your life, it's your career, dude. Maybe like take responsibility. I mean, if you're unhappy, do something about it or leave or whatever the heck. Okay. All in all, in the end, have compassion to yourself. We are human, we're built this way. People are born to bitch and to blame and to justify and to feel shame and so on. You can just try to be better tomorrow. And that's it. It's very, very, very important. And finally, Christopher Avery defines responsibility as owning your power and ability to create, choose, and attract your life. I mean, maybe it's a bad job you're stuck in, maybe the organization sucks, management is horrible, it's not agile, I mean, the list goes on and on, but it's still your life, after all, and no one else is responsible of that than you. Here's the responsibility model poster. You can download it online. It's also translated in Latvian. Stick it on your fridge door or something. Also, Christopher's book is pretty good, and there's lots of stuff online. And I have some more stuff as well. And it's like a Japanese photo session. Everybody done? And that's it for me. Thanks a lot. Any questions, comments? We have time. Maybe. Okay. Thanks. Yes, one question and a second one.
Okay. Sorry if it takes long. I haven't structured it in my mind. From different practices and trainings and so on, we typically talk about starting with I, moving to we, starting thinking as a group and what's good for the group and so on. And then there is kind of a bit contradictory messages like don't say we, and I have heard that from people as well. Stop saying we, because this is what you want. Yes, this is what I want, and we as a group need to do this. And it's very hard to find balance between these words.
Yeah.
How you see that?
Be careful with the language. I mean, if we want or we should, we could say, well, me and Joe and this other guy, Dima, it would be good if we would. Right? It's and I mean,
does
that
it make difference, really?
Maybe it will. I'm not sure. I forgot something else. Complete blank, blackout.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome. Not sure if I answered the question. Oh, yeah, right, at team level, like I know of teams who use this as a sense-making device, so but this has to be like obligatory, like they have a copy of the responsibility model on the wall, and when then they have a problem, problems, someone may ask, okay, so now that we're having this discussion, where are we on the responsibility process? Okay, we are blaming. Do we want to be there? Yes, this sucks. Okay, let's go have beer. 30 minutes of bitching, then come back. Now where do we want to be? Okay, let's think about this differently. So, I mean, yes, it can work as a community practice. Yeah.
I had a question about the freedom. You mentioned that like people need to have this freedom. Will it be counted if, for example, you are giving to developers like 5 issues to take and they are free to choose what to do? Or they should be like unlimited in their wishes?
Nah, it doesn't. It's a different issue, I guess. This is more, okay, here's the developer. He doesn't like your issues. Ultimately, he's free to change companies or decide to become a farmer, right? I mean.
Yeah, but like it's just like the consequences of this freedom. Does he take this responsibility or does he not?
It depends on his mental state. That's basically it.
So you can't like impact it, right?
No. No. You can teach this though. I hope that, I mean, one of you maybe picks up something useful from this one day. Okay, any other questions, comments? Okay, thanks. That was brilliant.
Thank you.